So what does that mean? What is a joint distribution? What does a jointly distributed random variable mean? Now, we are going to understand that in the beginning of the chapter, why joint distributions are important. Why do we need to model joint distributions? And then we are going to explain in this slide, in this presentation file, or in this half of the seventh chapter. So this is the first half of the seventh chapter. Just like the fifth chapter, the seventh chapter in our class, it consists of two parts. This is the first half of the seventh chapter, and there will be a second half as well. Now, in the first half of this chapter, we are going to learn about the joint and the marginal distributions. And for the first time, we are going to define the independence of random variables. Okay, so after learning the joint distribution and the marginal distributions, we will be able to define the independence between random variables. And this is the story of this chapter. So what is the outline? We are going to learn about the joint and the marginal distribution functions. First, we are going to talk about the joint and marginal cumulative distribution functions. So why do we start with cumulative distribution functions? Because, you know, the cumulative distribution function is a common function which is used to define both discrete and continuous random variables. Okay, so we are going to start speaking generally, and because CDF, the cumulative distribution function, is a function which is defined both for discrete and continuous random variables, it's a common concept. So we will first start learning the joint and marginal cumulative distribution functions of random variables. Then we are going to focus on the separation on the probability on discrete random variables and continuous random variables. So for discrete random variables, we are going to learn about the joint and the marginal probability mass functions. And for continuous random variables, we are going to learn about the joint and the marginal probability density functions of them. Then finally, in the last part of this section, or last part of this slide, we are going to learn about the independence among random variables, and we are going to define the independence again for discrete random variables first, then we are going to define it for continuous random variables, and finalize this chapter. And remember, now this is just the first half of the seventh chapter. There will be a second half of the seventh chapter as well in the week that is followed by the sacrifice eight. Okay, so why jointly distributed random variables are important? Now, in real life, the random quantities or random amounts that we observe, they possess dependence. So they are dependent on each other. For example, if you find an automobile outside, okay, let's just say in front of your house, there is an automobile that is parked, and you can see the brand of that automobile, you can see the color. However, what you do not know about this automobile is the odometer value, right? I mean, unless you go there and see it by yourselves, you wouldn't know the odometer value. What is the odometer value? How many kilometers it has traveled so far, right? That is the odometer value. So you see in front of your house, there's an automobile. You do not know the owner. You do not know anything about the owner. You do not know the odometer value of that automobile, which is a random variable, and it's a continuous random variable, right? So the amount of kilometers that it has traveled so far is what it is, a continuous random variable. Okay, now let's just say Y, capital Y, is the second hand price of that automobile. Okay, so you see the automobile, and the second-hand price of it is capital Y. Again, you wouldn't know about the second price as well. So it is also another continuous random variable. And I am asking you this question. If somebody tells you that the odometer value of that automobile that you see in front of your house is, for example, more than 200,000 kilometers, okay, if the odometer value is more than 200,000 kilometers, then you would say that the second-hand price is going to be very low, right? So the more kilometers that it have traveled so far is the less second hand price that it is going to have. Okay, I mean, even if you do not know the odometer value of that automobile, even if you do not know the second hand price of that automobile, what you know is this: if the odometer value is larger, then the second hand price is going to be lower. Okay, so this means what? There is a dependence between the second hand price of that automobile to the odometer value that you have, that you observe. So these two variables are random because you do not know them, but these two random variables are also dependent on each other, as well as they are dependent to the third random variable here. T is what? T is the gender of the last owner, let's just say, but T is a random variable. So we say that T is going to be equal to 1 if the last owner is a female, and it is going to be equal to 0 if the last owner is a male. Okay? So T is a Bernoulli random variable in that sense. So you can hear me, I guess. Right? You can hear me, my friends. Okay, thank you. Okay. So let's continue. T is the Bernoulli random variable, which indicates the gender of the last owner. And T is going to be equal to 1 if the last owner is a female, and it is going to be equal to 0 if the last owner is a male. So do you think that there is a dependence between the second-hand price, between the gender? I think yes, because usually if the last owner is a female, we expect a larger second-hand price, right? So they think that females use automobiles much more gently than men. Therefore, we think that the automobile gets less harm if the last owner is a female. Okay, so you see this random variable, which is discrete. It is a Bernoulli random variable. T is a discrete random variable. It has a dependence between the second-hand price of the automobile. So most probably, if T is equal to 1, Y is going to take a larger value, where if T is equal to 0, Y is going to take a lower value. And if X is dependent with Y and T is dependent with Y, there will also be an indirect dependence between X and T as well. So this means if the last owner of the automobile is a female person, then the odometer value is supposed to be low as well. Okay, usually female use the automobiles much less frequently than the male people. For example, you see, if you drive in the long distances, you usually see the drivers to be male, but in short distances we have equally like the chances. I mean, in short distances you can see the drivers to be female and male, but in long distances we usually observe male drivers. Okay, so therefore, if the gender of the owner is a female, then we usually observe that the odometer value is also low. So you see, all these three random variables are dependent on each other because they are dependent on the same automobile. They are defined on the same automobile that you see in front of your house. Okay? So we have random variables in real life which are concerning the same object, which are concerning the same object, and therefore they possess a certain dependence. So the less odometer value you observe, the higher the price will be. If the automobile is purchased from a female, then the price would be higher. If it is purchased from a female, then you will observe a less odometer value usually. But these are not guaranteed as well. I mean, there are exceptions as well. I mean, you will see some female drivers who are long distance drivers. Okay, so this has a lesser chance than the other one. Okay, so there may be exceptions as well. And for example, there may be other exceptions like that. You may see two automobiles of the same brand, of the same year, okay, which are manufactured in the same year and they are of the same brand. The odometer value of the first automobile is going to be less than the second automobile. However, its price is also going to be less. Why? maybe that automobile has an accident record. Okay? So these variables are dependent on each other, but these variables are also dependent on other random occurrences as well. So we cannot say that every time that we purchase an automobile from a female, the price is going to be higher. Maybe it is going to be lower, but usually we observe that the price is going to be higher. Okay? So they are random. These values are random. X, Y, and T are random. However, they have a dependence to each other as well. Okay? Now, our objective is what? We need to study that dependence because we are going to use this dependence modeling to predict the second-hand price of an automobile based on the odometer value. So you see, we have automobile experts, right? So when you go to an automobile expert and give the accident records an automobile and the odometer value and the list of the owners, previous owners, then that expert, because that expert is an expert, they predict the second-hand price of an automobile, right? Actually, what they are doing is not dependent on the expertise. It is dependent on a logic, right? So in their mind, in the expert's mind, there is a probability model, but this probability model is a subliminal model. So this means they do not exactly develop that mathematical model, but somehow that model is available in their mind, and they can predict the price of the automobile based on their past experiences because they know the dependence between the odometer value and the second-hand prices in their past experiences. Okay, so why should we be an expert if we have the data, right? So let's just say we have observed many second-hand automobiles and we have a data based on their odometer value and the second-hand price and the gender of the last owner. And we can develop a model, probability model, statistical model, where we can predict the price of an automobile, the price of a second-hand automobile based on the gender of the last owner and the odometer value that it has. Okay? So how can we do that? First, we need to model such dependencies. Okay? So this is why joint distributions are going to be used. Joint distributions are going to model two or more random variables at the same time. So we are going to define a joint cumulative distribution function to model two random variables simultaneously at the same time. Okay? So one by one, we are going to learn about these functions. And in the end, we are going to see how we can model more than two random variables at the same time. However, as a part of this course, we are just going to learn modeling two random variables at the same time. Okay, not more than two, but only two random variables at the same time. But if you study enough, you can generalize this. You can generalize this modeling to more than two random variables as well. So how I can model two random variables with a single distribution function? So I will use a joint cumulative distribution function. And that joint cumulative distribution function will be denoted by capital F of X and Y. So you see in the subscript here, in the index, you see two random variables, X and Y. So this means this CDF, this cumulative distribution function, is a joint cumulative distribution function, and it belongs to these two random variables, X and Y. So the CDF of random variables X and Y, the joint CDF of random variables X and Y at X and Y values, lowercase x and lowercase y values, means the probability of the first random variable to be less than or equal to lowercase x, intersection the second random variable y to be less than or equal to lowercase y. So this is basically, this CDF is a intersection probability of two events. First event is the first random variable to be less than or equal to x, and the second event is the second random variable to be less than or equal to 1. And that is an intersection probability. Now, my friends, because intersection sign creates a little complication when you want to read the statement, from now on, starting from this point of the lecture, instead of the intersection sign, I am just going to use the comma. Okay, I am just going to use the comma. So comma means what? Intersection. So this CDF, the CDF of XY, the joint CDF of XY at points X and Y is the probability of capital X to be less than or equal to X, and at the same time, capital Y to be less than or equal to Y. Okay, that expression raises the probability of X being less than or equal to X and Y being less than or equal to Y at the same time. Okay? And that index here indicates that this joint CDF belongs to two random variables, which are X and Y. Okay? Arkadaşlar, kitaplarda bazen iki değişken için tanımlanmış joint distribution'lara bivariate distribution adı verilir. Bivariate. Çünkü biliyorsunuz Latince'de bi iki demek. Bivariate distribution. So joint distribution is a general description. Joint distribution means this distribution belongs to more than or equal to two random variables. Okay? But if it says bivariate distribution, a bivariate distribution belongs to only two random variables. And in this course, we are just going to study bivariate distributions. Okay. Now, let's just say we have a joint cumulative distribution function, which belongs to two random variables, which is given in a closed form. Now, one can be interested in developing the marginal CDFs. So what is the marginal CDF of X? So the marginal means belongs to X. Okay, the marginal CDF of X means the CDF which just belongs to X. Now, remember, this notation is used for the cumulative distribution function of X, which is the probability of X being less than or equal to X, right? But while satisfying this probability, while satisfying this event, Y can take any value, right? So as long as X is less than or equal to X, this event occurs. So the probability of X being less than or equal to X is the joint probability of X being less than or equal to X, and Y can be less than infinity, anything that is less than infinity. So Y is free to take any value in this probability statement. So as the intersection of these two events, this event and the intersection of these two events are the same. Okay? So, and this probability is equal to what? The joint CDF of X and Y at X and infinity. So for X, we write lowercase x here, because x is supposed to be less than or equal to lowercase x. But for y value here, lowercase y value here, we simply write infinity, because random variable y can take any value. So this means if you have a closed form joint CDF function, by plugging in x in place of the first variable and infinity in place on the second variable, you can determine the marginal cumulative distribution function of X. Similarly, if you are interested in the marginal CDF of Y, which just belongs to random variable Y, you can calculate that marginal CDF by calculating the probability of Y being less than or equal to Y, but that probability is equivalent to the joint probability of X being less than or equal to infinity and Y being less than or equal to Y at the same time, which means while Y is taking less than or equal to values than Y, X is free to take anything. And that probability can be computed by the joint CDF of X and Y at infinity for the first value and Y for the second value. So again, by plugging in infinity in place of X and the certain real value in place of Y, you can calculate the marginal CDF of Y. So this means what? If you have the joint CDFs, you can always determine the marginal CDFs and the marginal PDFs as well. By taking the first derivative of the marginal CDFs, you can calculate the marginal PDFs. Or if X Of course, if X is a discrete random, X and Y are discrete random variables, in that case, taking the first derivative will not work. However, by taking the jump sizes at the possible values that the random variable can take, again, you can determine what the probability mass functions. However, it is not important at this point. Okay, so you see, if we are given a joint cumulative distribution function, it holds much more information than the marginal CDFs, because you can always compute the marginal CDFs that belongs to each respective variable from the joint CDF. However, if you know the marginal CDFs, that does not mean you can always compute the joint CDFs. Okay, it may not be practical because you may not know the dependence structure between these two variables. Okay, so the joint cumulative distribution functions, they hold all probabilistic information about these two random variables. You can always calculate the marginal probabilities based on the marginal cumulative distribution functions, which can be obtained through the joint cumulative distribution functions.